May be seated. What a way to start our service. It's all about the cross. It's all about the cross of Jesus. We are not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And this morning I gladly say I love Jesus with all my heart. Without him, I am nothing. Without him, I have nothing. He's my everything. Do you love him this morning, friends? We love him this morning. What a wonderful, wonderful Savior. And we want to welcome you all. It's lovely to see you all. We pray that God will bless you. You pray that you'll feel at home if you're visiting. This is God's house. This is not our church. This is his church. We are thrilled to have each and every one here this morning. It's lovely to see visitors. It's lovely to see friends here with us this morning. It's lovely to see you ladies. Where'd you come from, ladies? That's a long way to travel. You know, you Nigerians complain this. These are from Mountain Ash. It's great to have you this morning. We pray you'll be blessed. It's lovely to have Sandra with us this morning. We are thrilled to have you. What a welcome, Sandra. They don't clap for me. Huh? It's lovely to have you. Will you pray and ask God to bless us, Sandra? Thank you. Jesus.
It's a joy to know you as our Savior and Lord. We thank you, Lord, this morning because we can come around together and worship.
Every Friday morning. Oh, it's just great to be here. We thank God. It's lovely to see Alan's dad here. It's great to have you with us this morning. We are so pleased you were here. Coming in and enjoy God's presence. Now, we have so much to fit into this service this morning. And I was looking, I thought, what a great program. But we don't want a program. We want the presence of God. And so if God breaks in, we just thank him for what he's going to do. And we pray that he will just bless in a wonderful way. We're going to read from John chapter 18, please. John chapter 18, verses 1 to 9. John chapter 18, verses 1 to 9. Okay, follow this text because it's important. When Jesus had spoken these words, he went forth with his disciples over the brook Kedron, where was a garden, into the which he entered and his disciples. And Judas also, which betrayed him, knew the place, for Jesus oft-timed resorted thither with his disciples. Judas then, having received a band of men and officers from the chief priests and Pharisees, cometh thither with lanterns and torches and weapons. Jesus therefore, knowing all things that should come upon him, went forth and said unto them, Whom seek ye? They answered him, Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus saith unto them, I am he. And Judas also, which betrayed him, stood with them. As soon then as he had said unto them, I am he, they went backward and fell to the ground. Then asked he them again, Whom seek ye? And they said, Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus answered, I have told you, I am he. If therefore ye seek me, let these go their way, that the saying might be fulfilled, which he spake of them which thou gavest me, I have lost none. Isn't that incredible? Incredible. And we'll pray that God will open our minds, reveal himself to us, reveal his word to what this means. He's a wonderful, wonderful Savior. We have got to get straight on, so we're going to ask the choir to come forth. We're just singing a couple of songs this morning because of time. If you're in the choir, please, will you just make your way? Now, we've got a reduced number in our choir this morning, you see, because it's morning. A lot of them are still in bed, okay? But God is going to bless these that are singing this morning, I know, in a wonderful way. helpless. Behold his glory. Behold his face. Behold his presence is in this place. Do you believe he's here this morning? And he's going to bless us. He is blessing us. And we want to thank the choir. Can I ask you to sit down? Keep your gowns with you. Put them on the floor by your seat. Don't take them out. We haven't got time for that today. Just sit down. And can I say the choir will be singing all on Sunday morning, Sunday evening, and again on Monday evening. Make sure you're here. Don't miss it, whatever you do. And then I've got some even more good news. Did you think the choir was good? Yes. Even the people in the royal box up there thought the choir was good. So what we want is this. A week on Sunday, we are having the whole night for the choir to come and give our Easter musical. And some of the songs we've got are just incredible. Just incredible. And they'll be here for Sunday evening, not this Sunday, a week Sunday, for the musical. And of course, God's word is preached. We never have a service in this church where God's word isn't preached, because we're wasting our time if that happens. And so we just want to say thank you to the choir, and we just pray that God will continue to bless them. Just a few quick announcements. As I've said, tomorrow night is going to be Easter Nigerian style. As those in our church knows what that means, it's going to be very quiet, right? And then after we have our Easter service tomorrow, and it's going to be tremendous, and we believe that God is going to pack this place, then we're going to have refreshments, Nigerian style. So I've got my own little basket packed. I'm bringing my own little trifle and my Welsh cake, because I tell you, if you eat their food, you'll never speak for a month. But just come along and enjoy it. It's going to be tremendous tomorrow, tremendous. And then Sunday morning, up from the grave, he arose. Hallelujah. With a mighty triumph for his force, he arose the victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. He arose. He arose. Hallelujah. He arose. And I hope by Sunday we'll get a little bit excited about Jesus. And then Sunday evening, our great gospel service, we know that God is going to move. We believe that many souls are going to be saved over this weekend. And then again, we are here on Monday evening. And that's just going to be something tremendous. That's going to be something tremendous as we look at God's word. Do you know, I want to speak about when Jesus was whipped. I want to speak about when Jesus was whipped. So often we forget these things, we read past them, but I tell you, the meaning behind the flogging that Jesus took is incredible. And we're going to come and we're going to be blessed, I know. So please remember, can I just say to you too, I want to thank every person that's been giving leaflets out. I was amazed on the bus coming into church this morning. We picked up quite a number of people. And one of our young ladies, who put her life right with Jesus here just about a year ago. I don't want you to take me home, Pastor, she said. I'm going round the doors in Tree Forest, knocking all the doors to tell them about Jesus. Isn't that amazing? Give her a clap. I want to tell you, friends, that takes some courage. That takes some courage, and there'll be people rushing off from this service. We want to go down the beach. We want to do this. We want to do that. I want to tell you, friends, when you put Jesus first, you're going to be blessed. You're going to be blessed. And so there's much more. All I can say that God is going to bless and God is going to speak to each one. We're going to remain seated for the first verse or two. We're going to sing Thank You for the Cross. And we're going to remain seated and take up our offering this morning, please.
It all, Lord. Hallelujah. separate us from your love.
Thank you for the nail pierced.
You washed us clean.
Reason that we are here this morning, because he alone is worthy. He alone is worthy. We thank God for that. When John the Baptist said, "Behold the Lamb of God," thank God this morning that he taketh away the sin of the world, your sin and my sin. And we give him thanks, and we give him praise, and we give him glory this morning. We're going to come to God's word in just a moment, but before we do, I've asked if Lydia would come and sing for us, please. So Lydia's going to come and sing right now.
Little mention of the blood anymore. Some have even removed it from the pages of God's word. They say it's out of style, it's not relevant today. Though the world may deny it, I am not ashamed to say I cherish the blood, the precious blood Jesus shed on Calvary. It will never lose its power, even in this last hour. It still flows for you. And says you've gone too far to be forgiven of your sins. When all of us were guilty, we were all condemned to die, except for the blood of Jesus Christ. I cherish the blood, precious blood Jesus shed on Calvary. It will never lose its power, even in this last hour. It still flows for you and me. When he cried, it is finished, and the spear pierced his side. It's open. That will never run dry. I'm unworthy of this kind of love. That's why I cherish the blood. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. Will never run dry. I'm unworthy of this kind of love. That's why I cherish the blood.
Cherish the blood this morning, dear. That's why I cherish the blood. I'm unworthy of this kind of love. That's why I cherish the blood. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Do you thank God for the blood, friends? Do you thank God for the blood? Where would we be without the blood of Jesus? We just thank God for his sacrifice and his love for each one of us here this morning. We come in to God's word, and those that come to this church will know that at this time we turn off every mobile phone. We want no mobile phone ringing when we come to God's word. God is speaking to us. We want no one else speaking to us. And when we preach God's word, there's no movement. There's no one moving around. You see, this word is too sacred to play around with. That's what the world has done in the time in which we live. That's what the so-called church of today have done. They've played around with God's word, and God's not having it. And he wants us to come back to his word and to listen and to serve and to follow his word. Can I just say this morning, we are praying that many souls will be saved. We are praying that this morning someone will find Jesus as Savior and Lord. Last Sunday morning, we've seen 7 souls come to Jesus. And one of the gentlemen that came to Jesus had been coming to this church a long time, and I thought, when he comes to the prayer meeting, he comes here, and he gave his life to Jesus last week, and a number of others. We thank God. Do you know, the blood has still its power. The power in the blood is still the same today as it always has been and always will be. So we're going to pray that God will open his word to us now. It's lovely to see you, Amanda. Good to see you this morning. The choir sang 3/4 hour ago. Thank you for being part of the choir. Namdi's up there. Thank you so much. Appreciate that. Marvelous. We're going to pray right now. Loving Heavenly Father, as we come to your word, will you open your word to us, Lord? We don't want to hear what a man has to say. Lord Jesus, we don't want to see a man. We want to see Jesus. And we truly say this morning, will you hide the man behind the cross? Lord Jesus, we pray, will you allow each individual here to hear your voice, to know, Lord Jesus, something more, just a little bit more about the sacrifice that you made for each and every one of us. And as we hear about what you have done for us, to help us to say we must do more for you, Lord. Lord, we pray, breathe upon us, reveal yourself to us, Lord, that your name will be exalted and glorified in this place. Speak, we pray. In your name we ask it. Amen. Amen. We're coming to a little passage of scripture that I believe is important that each one of us think about this morning. In Matthew, Mark, and Luke, the Synoptic Gospels, we have the picture of Jesus falling to the ground before the Father. How incredible was that? Remember when he fell in the garden to the ground and sweat drops of blood? And he fell to the ground before his Heavenly Father and said, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. But nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. And I want to tell you this morning, friends, every sweat drop of blood that run down his face was for you and me. For you and me. But in John's Gospel, friends, we have the picture of not Jesus falling to the ground before his Father, but we have those who are coming to arrest the Savior falling to the ground before him. What a picture. What a picture. The enemies of Christ falling to the ground before him. And I want to tell you, friends, my Bible says something wonderful. Do you know, I can never keep the last bit of my sermon till the end. I get so excited about it. The Bible says this, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess to the glory of God the Father. Can I tell you, friends, that Putin will bow before God. Every evil person that has ever lived, that ever will live, will bow at the name of Jesus. And I want to tell you this morning, friends, that it's better to bow willingly than having to bow. And if you were here this morning and you don't know Jesus, friends, bow your knee to him this morning. Ask him into your life to cleanse your soul, to make you ready for heaven. And I want to tell you, friends, something wonderful will take place. And so even the band of soldiers Yet as a command, and the disciples are allowed to go unmolested. Isn't it amazing? Jesus utters the command. They had come to take him, but he utters the command. Matthew, Mark, and Luke tell us of the agony of our Lord in the garden. But John passes over it. Why? I believe, friend, John in his gospel wanted to present the Lord as the God-man. The God-man. Matthew, Mark, and Luke present him in his humanity. But John presents him in his divinity. What a savior. For example, friends, in the genealogy of the Lord Jesus, Matthew begins his gospel by calling the Lord Jesus the son of Abraham and the son of David. Then Luke in his gospel goes a little bit further and he says the son of Adam and the son of Seth. But John goes further than them all and he goes into eternity and he declares this, the Lord Jesus as the Son of God. He says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was the beginning with God. And he says, and the Lord became flesh, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld his glory as of the glory as the begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. The Gospel of John, friends, is essentially the Gospel of the divinity and the deity of Jesus, our precious Lord. And secondly, I wanted to notice something else that is very striking, friends. The garden he mentions is the same one also mentioned by Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And they all call it Gethsemane, which means the garden of crushed olives. Showing us, friends, that our Savior was crushed like an olive to the ground. Because of the enormous weight of your sin, of your guilt, of your mistakes, he was broken, he was crushed. But John singularly, friends, and significantly, omits the name Gethsemane. In its place, he mentions the brook Kedron. Do you know, friends, what Kedron means? In the Greek New Testament, it means dark waters. It was to John the emblem of the black stream which his Lord was about to go over. His Lord is about to pass over. Not only that, friends, but John in his gospel is the only gospel writer who continually stresses that Jesus is the Lamb of God. The Lamb of God. So John, that night, God sacrificed a sacrificial lamb. To John that night, God was sacrificial lamb. He was crossing the brook to the end, to end all sacrifices. No wonder he says, friend, behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. And then thirdly, John omits to tell us something that Matthew, Mark, and Luke stresses to tell us. But I have found, friends, that John's omission actually gives us more information. In Matthew, Mark, and Luke, we have Judas kissing Jesus, which was the sign to the Roman authorities that this man was the one that they had to take. But notice how John tells it. He says in verse 3, Judas then, having received a band of men and officers from the chief priests and Pharisees, cometh thither with lanterns and torches and weapons. Jesus, therefore, are you ready for this? Knowing all things. Jesus knowing. Oh, friends, if you thought something terrible was going to happen to you, you'd make sure you went the other way. Jesus knowing. He knew what was going to happen. Listen to what my Jesus did. Jesus, therefore, knowing all things that should come upon him, went forth and said to them, whom seek ye? Whom seek ye? Did you notice what Jesus did? He stepped out into the light of their lanterns. He stepped out. He wanted them to know he was there. He was waiting for them. He was ready, friends. Notice the marvelous courage and the determination of the Lord Jesus that the will of God should be accomplished. He goes right into the open and he meets them. Friends, if you want an example of courage, look no further than Jesus. There is no greater example of courage than Jesus. He is the Christ of courage. No one can equal him. I want to tell you, friends, he's far above all. Friends, if you want an example of courage, look to the Master. He doesn't run away from trouble. He doesn't hide from trouble. He goes into the open and he meets it. And he meets them. This is what John is trying to tell us, friends. If the Master had not gone forward to meet them, he could have got away. Did you notice it was dark? Did you notice they brought lanterns and all the rest of it? But Jesus wasn't trying to get away. Jesus was waiting for them. He knew his hour had come. And he steps out in front of them to meet them. And Jesus majestically walks into the glow of these torches so that he could be seen. And so that he could be identified. And so that he could be recognized. It was after this that Judas kissed him. Did you notice Jesus made himself known without the kiss of Judas? Without the kiss of the traitor? I want to tell you, friends, Jesus was ready. Jesus stepped out into the open to give his cheek to the traitor's kiss and to give himself to those who had come to take him. Friends, this morning, isn't he a wonderful Savior? Isn't he a wonderful Savior? This was the start, friends, of Jesus giving himself for me and for you. The Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. No one took his life. He laid it down. No one took him. No one took him by force. He gave his life for you, that you and I can know full salvation. Once we are told, friends, in John chapter 6, they wanted to take him by force to make him a king. After that miraculous feeding of 5,000. But we are told that he departed from them. You see, if that had been me or you, we would have been waiting for them. Come on, give me all the glory. Give me all the praise. Give me everything. Give me the publicity. It says he departed from them. But now that he is going to be scourged, now that he is going to be crucified, now that he is going to be nailed to a cross, now that he is going to have the crown of thorns crushed into his head, and he knew all this was happening, he went forward to meet them. He went forward to meet them. He boldly advances. He didn't want the glory, friends. He wanted to be the sin bearer for you and for me. And I got to ask you this morning, friends, do you love him? Yes. Do you love him this morning? Yes. I want to tell you, friends, what a precious example he is to every one of us. For when a crisis hits us, friends, or overtakes us, we are looking for a way out. We are looking for a place to run. But he didn't run anywhere. He was not looking for a place out. If you remember, friends, that night in the garden before the rabble that came to take him, he cried, "Father, if you be willing, remove this cup from me." And then he says these wonderful words, "Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done." Oh God, will you help us, your servants, your followers? Will you help us to say the same? Not my will, but thy will be done. And I want to tell you, friends, if his will is done, this church will be packed to the doors. This church will be packed. There won't be a seat left when we tell people of the love of Jesus. The Bible says, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. This is the one, friends, I worship this morning. He was in the center of God's perfect will. And you know, a lovely thought came to me. You can be in the center of God's perfect will when you're suffering. Isn't that amazing? If you're here this morning, you're going through a tough time, it doesn't mean that you're out of God's will. Very often it means you're right there in the center of God. You can be in the center of God's perfect will, friends, for trouble to hit you and your home and your family. You can be in the center of God's perfect will for a disaster to hit you. But God will work out his purpose. Can you remember those disciples on the boat? They were totally safe. You see, we forget the word of God. Jesus said to them, "I want to go over to the other side." Yeah. They were going over to the other side. Didn't matter what happened in between. They were going to the other side. And when the waves, they got frightened. They shouldn't have been frightened. If I was there, I would have been frightened, would you? But they shouldn't have been frightened. Jesus had said, "You're going to the other side." And when he says that, you're going to the other side. Yes. But when the storm came, they were right in the center of God's perfect will. Because God had put them there. God had put them on that board. And I want to tell you this morning, whatever you're going through, friends, as long as you're serving Him and you love Him, He'll bring you through. He'll take you through every disaster and every problem. Why? Because the power of the cross. Why? Because the power of His resurrection. Why? Because the power of the blood. He's ready, friends. He was in the center of God's perfect will. And when a man and a woman, friends, are in the center of God's perfect will, as He was, you can meet any disaster and you'll be able to stand in the midst of your trouble and know that He is with you and still be going on with God. This was the greatest crisis, friends, in His ministry in the eyes of men. But in the eyes of God and in the eyes of Christ, this was the supreme part of His ministry. Nothing like it. This is what He had came for. Everything was going to plan, God's plan. He bravely advanced to meet them. Oh, may the Holy Ghost impart to us some of the faith and the courage of our Master. Then fourthly, you say, how many points do you have? 27. Whoa, we'll spend all weekend, yeah. Isn't that amazing? Fourthly, if you look at verse 5 and 6 in reply to our Lord's question, whom seek ye? They answered him, Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus saith unto them, I am he. And Judas also, which betrayed him, stood with them. Oh, I want to tell you, friends, there's some useless, weak, jelly-spined Christians today that are standing with the world, and we should be standing with Christ. And I want to tell you, friends, get on your knees and ask God to forgive you for the way you live. Stand for Jesus. For if you stand for Him here, He'll stand for you in eternity. I want to tell you, friends, He'll do it for you. Are you standing for Him this morning? Are you standing with the world? Where are you taking your stand, friends? Here we are told Jesus, Judas stood with them. But when we are told, friends, as soon as Jesus said, I am He, it said they went backward and fell to the ground. Now, if you notice, friends, Judas came, it says, with a band of men. Now, in the Greek New Testament, a band was a tenth part of a legion or a cohort. And if you work it out, friends, it's approximately 600 men. Now, do you know, as a young person, I used to think, oh, they came to Jesus with a few soldiers come. That's not right. Read your Bible. Approximately 600 men came to take Jesus. If you compare this with Matthew chapter 26, we are told that Judas came with a great multitude to arrest Jesus. To arrest a lowly peasant, 600 men came for one man. What a man! What a man, the Christ Jesus! No man like this man. No man spake like this man. No man lived like this man. No man was born like this man. No man died like this man. No man rose from the dead like this man. No man ascended to glory like this man. No man is coming back like this man. Jesus is on His way. Jesus is on His way. And I want to tell you, friends, you need to be ready. You need to be ready, friends. 600 men. Isn't he wonderful, friends? There they were to arrest him. But instead of advancing to lay hands on him, they retreated. 600 men, 600 Roman soldiers, temple police and priests. Yet they collapsed at the single words of Jesus. I am. I am. Whom seek ye? Jesus of Nazareth. I am He. And as soon as He said, I am, they fell backward to the ground. This was a miracle, friends. It was an exercise of the last time that the same divine power by which our Lord had used through His life. Remember when He calmed the waves, a miracle. When He stilled the storm, a miracle. When He cast out devils, a miracle. When He raised the dead, a miracle. And it was a miracle purposely done, friends, at this time, in order to show the disciples and their enemies that our Lord was not taken because he could not stop it. He was not crucified because he could not prevent it, but because he was willing to suffer and die for sinners just like you and me. Because he was willing to suffer, friends, and to die for you. I am, he said. I am, and they collapsed to the ground. And let us not forget, friends, that the little phrase where it says, I am he. If you look at it, you will notice, friends, that it is written in italics. But in the Greek word, he wasn't there. He wasn't there. So the word he was, that was put there by the commentators just to help us and explain it to us. And so he said, whom seek ye? And they said, Jesus of Nazareth. And he said, I am. I am. I am. He is the great I am. I am he that liveth and was dead. And I'm alive forevermore. And that's why I'm here this morning, friends. That's why I'm rejoicing this morning. He's alive. Hallelujah. He's alive. And yet God permitted the ark of his strength to be put into the hands of wicked men. John, throughout his gospel, emphasizes Jesus, the great I am. What does that mean? Simply this, friends. It was the revelation of his divine person, the very name of God revealed to Moses at the burning bush in Exodus chapter 3. Remember when Moses said to God, whom will I say sent me? And God replied, thou shalt say unto the children of Israel, I am, hath sent me unto you. And here the Lord Jesus said, I am. And as soon as he said, I am, they fell backwards to the ground. What a savior. John, throughout his gospel, friends, emphasizes that Jesus is the great I am. Do you know, friends, the church of Jesus today have made Jesus small. We've made him small. We are frightened to speak for Jesus. We are frightened to stand for Jesus. We are frightened to stand against the filth and the wrong that our government passes and the rubbish and the nonsense that have been brought into our land. Can I tell you, friends, that we have the great I am. There is no one greater. There is no one stronger. There is no one more powerful. He is the great I am. Listen to him, friends, in John chapter 10. Listen to him. He says, I am the good shepherd. I am the bread of life. He says, I am the true vine. He says, I am the door. He says, I am the light of the world. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life, the resurrection and the life. And listen to him again, friends. Before Abraham was, he says, I am. Did you notice when he said that? They were laughing at him. Thou art not 50 years old, they said unto him. And how do you know Abraham? He says, Abraham, Abraham, before Abraham was, I am. I am. Why do you not trust him, friends? He has been there all the time. You see, he was there before you were your existence. He was there when you were conceived. He was there when you received your grandchildren. He is the great I am yesterday. He is the great I am today, and he is the great I am tomorrow. Now in the garden, friends, the garden of humiliation, the master put down that multitude with his breath. I am. Just said the words, they were down. That's the power of our God. That's the power of our God. What a savior. Now fifthly, and lastly, I want you to look at verse 8. Jesus answered, I have told you that I am. If therefore ye seek me, let these go their way. Here, friends, is a beautiful thing that you seldom hear mentioned in their crucifixion story by preachers and teachers. But John tells us, here is the shepherd still protecting the sheep. The shepherd is about to be taken, but he still is protecting his sheep. Christ's first thought is not of himself and what he was about to suffer, but about his disciples. Isn't that amazing? That's true love, isn't it? His first thought this morning, whether you believe it or not, friends, is to you. The Bible says he intercedes for you and me. At this very moment, he intercedes. John was right in chapter 13 when he said, having loved his own, he loved them to the end. No greater love. No greater love. Those 11 disciples, friends, would never forget the last act of their master. Here the Savior majesty shines forth again. In the garden, he's about to be taken prisoner. But he acts not as a helpless prisoner, but rather like a king. He says, let these go their way. You're not going to take me. You can't take me. It's an impossibility. You let these go. Just an uttered command, friends, and they go their way. He speaks as a conqueror, and so he was, for he had thrown them to the ground by just his word of his lips. And now they were about to tie his hands behind his back, and he allows them to do this once he sees that his disciples are safe. Now Matthew and Mark and Luke says they fled, but it was his word of command that allowed them to flee. Friends, who is your idol this morning? Do you have an idol this morning? Do you know there are people and they say, oh, my idol is a certain sports person. My idol is a politician. My idol is some superstar. Do you know, as a young person, I had many idols. I remember my pastor, Pastor Alex T, he was my idol. Oh, could I be like him? Could I preach like him? Never in a million years. I remember looking at Pastor Ron Jones. Could I speak like him? Never in a million years. Charles Haddon Spurgeon. Charles Haddon, what a man. What a man. Could I be a Charles Haddon Spurgeon? Never in a million years. But I want to tell you, friends, as I look to those men, there's a far greater idol. And this morning, my idol is Jesus Christ. And because he live, I live also. And I want to tell you, friends, I am nothing, but he is everything. And he is able to speak. And as he speaks to his servants, men and women can come to know Jesus, whom to know is life eternal. My idol is Jesus. Is your idol Jesus this morning? Is he Jesus this morning? Friends, I tell you this morning, I want to be more like Jesus. He speaks like a conqueror, and so he was. He allows himself to be taken, for he must fulfill the scriptures. When he said in John 10 and 17 and 18, you ready for this? He says, I lay down my life that I might take it up again. No man taketh it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it up again. This was no empty statement, friends. He meant every word that he said. Every word that he said. Oh, Jesus, what a savior. So if none had power to take his life from him, then none had power to arrest him. And so our savior gave us proof, friends, that he allowed himself to be our substitute and to be our answer to sin. No wonder Isaiah said, by his stripes we are healed. On him was laid the iniquity of us all. I've got to just say, and we're drawing to a close soon, by his stripes, we are healed. Amen. Monday evening after the service, we want you to bring those that are sick. We're going to pray in the name of Jesus, by his stripes, not by my words, by his stripes, they will be healed. Amen. Any disease, whatever it may be, I said on Wednesday, don't bring someone who's got a headache. Give them a few paracetamol. Bring people that have no hope. Bring that have no hope. Bring them in. The doctor said it's over. Bring them here. And we'll pray and Jesus will heal them. Yes. By his stripes we are healed. He died because he chose to die, friends. And he chose to die for you. And he chose to die because of his love for you. Now there's a thought I want to leave with you this morning. The apostles, those 11, that he said, let those go their way. The apostles would have to die for him someday, but they were not ready yet. They were not ready yet. There are things, friends, that God has set out for you and for me, but you're not ready yet. You're not ready yet. So God will hide it from you. So they were not ready. And he cast the shield of his protection round about them in order that their weakness may have a little more time to grow strong. You're going to die for me, Peter, but you're not ready yet. James, you're going under Herod's sword, but you're not ready yet. John, the youngest of them, probably around 17 or 18 years of age. John, you're going to live the longest of them all, and you're going to be on the Isle of Patmos alone. But he said, I'll be there with you. I'll be there with you. You're not really alone, never alone when you have Jesus, but he was not ready yet. And we're not ready for a lot of things, friends, that he has for us. We protect us until we are. He looks after us until we are. There are times, friend, when the enemy would have destroyed you and you didn't even realize it. Do you know that? Do you realize that? There are times when the enemy would have destroyed you. Satan hates you, friends. Hates you. He's a defeated foe this Easter. He's defeated, but he wants to take you down to hell with him. But Jesus came that you would rise from the dead in his power. There are times, friends, when the enemy would have wiped you out, but he came and interposed himself between you and the enemy. There are times when things were plotted against you that would have destroyed you, but he turned things around and through his Spirit, he kept you. Again, I say to you, friends, this morning, he's a wonderful Savior. He's a wonderful. Why does he do it? Because he knows that you're not ready yet. And though it was wrong and cowardly for the disciples to forsake him and flee, even when he said, let them go their way, yet he gave them permission in their weakness. Two out of three whom Christ protected, friends, in that garden, died martyrs. James bowed his neck more joyfully to the sword of Herod. And Peter let them guide him to the cross more joyfully as they considered him who had died for them. They went willingly. Many have said to me, friends, it would be a great privilege to die for Jesus. It would be. But can I tell you something here this morning? It's a greater privilege to live for him. Amen. To live for him. As long as you're living for him his way. What does that mean? I'll tell you what it means. It means dying to yourself daily. Dying to yourself daily. I believe, friends, it would be a great honor to live for Jesus. Because when a man truly lives for him, in a sense, he will be dying daily. When a man truly lives for him, in a sense, friends, he is dying for himself because you're a true witness. And if you're a true witness, the word witness comes from the word martyrs, which means martyr. You see, the darkest prison cell will not be so dark when we realize that he has been there before us. You see, there's no need to fear death anymore. Why? The hymnist said, death has lost its sting. Oh, isn't that marvelous? Death has lost its sting, friends, because Christ has taken the sting for us. Death in itself will be softened into a sleep because the sting of death has been taken by Christ. But listen, friends. Was he not illustrating the picture that is shown to us as the Good Shepherd in John chapter 10? He did not flee when he saw the wolf coming. He was surrounded by wolves, but he gave his own life for the sheep. 600 wolves came to the garden that night. But this incident shows also, friends, the great work of redemption. The Lord Jesus procures the deliverance of his people by surrounding himself and surrendering himself to shame and suffering and death. While they go their way in joy and in safety, so watchful was he in their time of panic and fear. The truth would finally dawn, friends, upon them later as they recalled his high priestly prayer in John chapter 17. Listen to these words. Of those whom thou gavest me, have I lost none. I gave my heart to Jesus, friends, when I was 7 years old. And I'm 60 years of age now. And I love him more today than I've ever loved him before. There's no one like Jesus. So, Pastor, Jesus saved you when you were 7? No. I was his before the foundation of the world. Isn't that marvelous? The Bible says I was his before the foundation. He knew me. He knew little old me. He loved me. And he was determined to die for me. That's my Jesus, friends. Of those whom I was given have I lost none. All that the Father giveth me shall come to me. And him that cometh unto me I will never cast out. No one who ever put their trust in Christ, friends, will ever perish. We are safe in Christ as we are serving Christ with all our heart. No power can take us out of the hand of Jesus. Let me close by saying that our blessed Lord was never dragged. He was never driven. He was led. He was a willing submission. Like Samson, he could have burst the bonds asunder, but he was led as a lamb to the slaughter. Here he not only fulfilled prophecy, friends, but the Old Testament in Leviticus chapter 17, it says each animal that was to be offered in sacrifice was to be brought to the high priest. And so the Lord Jesus was brought to Caiaphas. And as soon as he was brought to Caiaphas, God is saying, that's my lamb. And Caiaphas examined him, and then onto the other high priest, tried in the middle of the night, onto Pilate and onto Herod, to Pilate again, and then led out that morning carrying his cross. The gate from the city of Jerusalem, friends, to Olivet, to Gethsemane, was called the Sheep Gate. And through it, the sacrificial animals passed. And so he, to fulfill the type, passed through the Sheep Gate and was the Lamb of God. What a wonderful, wonderful Savior. I am not ashamed of Jesus. I love him with all my heart. Do you love him this morning, friends? Turn your eyes upon Jesus, and he will guide you, and he will lead you, and he will deliver you. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Let's bow in prayer. As you bow in prayer this morning, I want you to look at where you are in Christ. Do you know Jesus this morning? You come to church, it means nothing. You're religious, it means nothing. I know scriptures off by heart, it means nothing. Friends, it's not knowing the scripture, it's knowing the author of the scripture. It's knowing Jesus yourself as your Savior and Lord. And I'm looking this morning here, is there someone here, is there one person that Jesus brought here this morning because he knows you need to put your life right? You've pretended long enough. It's time for you to know Jesus as your Savior and Lord. I'm just going to ask once, time is gone. It always goes when we're in God's presence. Is there someone here? Raise your hand right now. Raise your hands. I want Jesus to cleanse me from my sin. I want Jesus to be my Savior and my Lord. I'm looking right now, friends. Have the courage. He died for you. Will you live for him? Is there someone here this morning? Raise your hand quickly. Loving Heavenly Father, we pray for each one that is in your house this morning. We pray, Lord Jesus, that they will know your presence. That, Lord, if they are not right with you, Lord, that you will continue to speak to them and never stop speaking to them, Lord, until they realize that they need to give their life to you. Bless each one, we pray. In your name we ask it. Amen. We are going to come around the table. If ever there's a place where we come and you want to see what Jesus did for you, this is it, friends. This is it. This is the what Jesus did. He died. His body, the Bible says, was broken. His blood was shed. And we have come to remember him. Remember him. And so as we bow in prayer, as you bow in prayer right now, just give him thanks. Give him praise for all that he's done. I just want to read a little bit of scripture to you. For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. And after the same manner also he took the cup. And when he had supped, saying, This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till he come. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. Loving Heavenly Father, how can we thank you? How can we thank you for taking our place upon Calvary? How can we thank you, Lord, for your body being broken, for the shame that you took, Lord, for the blood that you shed? Oh God, we pray as we partake of this communion service this morning, Lord, draw yourself close to us. Lord, make yourself more real to every single one of us. And help us to love you more. In your name we ask it. Amen. Amen. Would those who are serving please come to the table? The bread is body broken for you. So this do in remembrance of me. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Wonderful Savior. Oh, what a Savior. His blood shed. Wonderful, wonderful Jesus. Jesus, we thank you, Lord. His body broken. This do in remembrance of me in the name of Jesus. Oh, this morning, friends, your heart should be filled with joy and thankfulness. Jesus. I love the man of Calvary. I love the man of Calvary. At the end of the service, could you play Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus? Can you do that? Amen. Amen. Thank you, Mike. Thank you. Thank you, Lana. Thank you, Mike.
I thank you. I have the privilege to come here, Lord.
Amen. Jesus.
And on this day, Lord, we remember the cost, Lord. It
because of what you've done for us, Lord. I just pray that you'll always make us faithful for this glorious day, Lord, that you've done for us. Amen.
Jesus. Hallelujah. Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Hallelujah. Jesus. Jesus. Jesus, we thank you, Lord. Jesus. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Sam. Sam.
I want to thank you, and I thank you that you are a humble servant myself, and I always want to be able to stand.
I want to get those words ready. Yeah, Jenny, nice about Jesus. Not yet. Jesus, we thank you, Lord.
I give you all the glory and honor the Jesus. Rest of my days, Lord.
Oh, God, we thank you, Lord.
Almighty God, you are.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Jesus, we thank you, Lord. Amen. Jesus, we thank you, Lord. Thank you, Mike. Amen. To the end, there's no place for argument. You are God all by yourself. God, from beginning to the end, there's no place for argument. You are God all by yourself. this day and tomorrow and for the rest of our lives, Lord. Eternity will be too short to praise you for who you are and for what you've done. And we just give you the thanks this morning, Lord. We thank you for your presence in this place. We thank you, Lord, for the choir. We thank you, Lord, for Lydia, for the singing, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for your word. But above all, we thank you for Jesus. Lord Jesus, just continue to move and bless your people, we pray. In your name we ask it. Amen. 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 Now, I had a great hymn to end with, but I don't want us to sing that hymn. I want us to sing a simple little chorus that we used to sing many, many years ago. And it simply says this: turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. And the things of this earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and his grace. It's a simple little song, and we'll sing it through a couple of times. And then there's a verse, a new verse that someone penned, and I like it. We'll sing that as well as we close and as we go away rejoicing in a living Christ. I want to thank the choir for singing this morning. Wasn't the choir great? I want to thank Lydia for singing, and I pray God will bless her. I want to thank you all for coming. But I want to tell you something, friends. This place should be packed because Jesus died for you and me. Don't forget tomorrow night. Come early and enjoy wonderful blessing tomorrow. All day, Sabbath day, Sunday morning, we're going to be looking at the whipping that Jesus took. Don't miss it. Make sure people are here. And then we'll conclude this weekend on Monday evening. Make sure you're back here. Bring someone with you. Don't let nothing stop you. And God will bless you. Let's just stand and sing, turn your eyes upon Jesus. And if someone's here and you want to know Jesus as your Savior, you walk down to the front as we are singing this song, and we'll pray for you.
Thank you.
Get back here tomorrow. Every service, don't miss one. Bring someone with you. And let us rejoice as we see these pews filled. More than that, as men and women give their lives to Christ. Paul, pray for us, please.